Mark and family, and thank you, Randy. Thank you. Yeah, that's all right. Thank you, as Steve said, for taking some time out of your golden years. You know why they call it the golden years? You can ask Randy later, but it's because it takes gold to get through them. But today is a good day. God is on the throne. He's almighty. Today is a good day. It's above 40 degrees, finally. Today is a good day because we're here, and today is a good day because we're reminded to honor, to celebrate, to pay homage and tribute to those who have served our country so well, so faithfully. Some, as Steve shared, who gave the ultimate sacrifice, and others who sacrificed years of their lives, opportunities that they would never go back and have again for our freedom. It's a good day. My dad was in World War II, Battle of the Bulge, among other conflicts that he experienced. Thank God he came back home. Thank God he became my dad. And Dad was a craftsman. He had tools, lots of tools. And I always got excited when he would give me one of his tools. Now, only a few of you in those golden years remember that when you would go to cut a board, you either had a yardstick or you had one of these rulers that was attached to another ruler, another ruler, another ruler, and you would kind of spread it out, and you could measure your board. Well, then they came along with an invention called the tape measure. And not with a fancy spring inside, but you actually have to crank this tape measure to get it to go back up. Well, I was proud that I was the only kid my age who had a tape measure. Remember the first time I used my tape measure? We were young marrieds, never used it before that, and I had to cut a board. And so I pulled my tape measure out, and I measured the exact spot where it was supposed to be, and I cut the board, and I went to put the board up, and it didn't fit. And I tried it again, and it didn't fit. Well, three boards later, I finally realized my tape measure wasn't accurate. I don't know how we're going to... There we go. It was almost the right length. This tape measure has a flaw. It's a quarter of an inch longer than it's supposed to be. But it's almost right, and you can almost get the board just right. Almost. It's a simple word we all use, isn't it? It's a word we use almost every day. There's a lot of almost moments in our lives. It can mean sort of, kind of, maybe, not quite, not exactly. And sometimes it just plain means no. Kind of like our friend Nerwin. Nerwin, did you do your homework? Almost. Almost is a lot like no, isn't it? It's exactly like no, now that you mention it. Yeah, it's an everyday word we use, and it's sometimes a good excuse, or it just conveys our best effort. Or how about the bridge to nowhere? How many have been to the bridge to nowhere? Oh, I'm on my own here. Okay, well, in 1936, north of Azusa, California, there was meant to be a road connecting the San Gabriel Valley with Wrightwood, California. And they needed a bridge across a very steep gully in order to make the road work. Well, they built the bridge. And, you know, that's a pretty nice bridge. But look where the bridge goes. The bridge goes to nowhere. See, they never finished the road. They almost finished the road, but again, almost doesn't count. Or how about this one? And we can say, they almost made it work. Good job, guys. good help is hard to get, isn't it? And so, I don't know if that picture's accurate, but I thought it's worth showing. Then there was King Saul. King Saul. Yeah. 1 Samuel 15, if you have your Bible with you, if you have the text in your phone or in your tablet, you might want to try to follow along. If you don't, it's okay. But Samuel said to Saul, I'm the one the Lord sent to anoint you king over his people Israel. So listen now to the message from the Lord. That to me is the first key phrase of this text. And if God is speaking to us, he's simply saying, listen now. Listen now to the message from the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty says. These are the key three words of this entire story. I, God says, will, infinitive, imperative, will punish the Amalekites. He didn't say, Saul, you're going to punish the Amalekites. He didn't say, your army is going to punish the Amalekites. He said, I, God Almighty, the great God that we just sang about, is going to do what he says he's going to do. This is his plan. And even if we mess up on planet Earth, guess what? God is still going to accomplish his plan, is he not? He says, I will punish the Amalekites for what they did to Israel when they ambushed Israel, when the Israel came up from Egypt. Now, go. Go, Saul. The mission from God. Attack the Amalekites. And what was Saul's mission? Totally destroy all that belongs to them. Do not spare them. This is where it gets kind of hard to read, but put to death all the people, men, women, children, cattle and sheep, all the cattle, all the sheep, all the camels, and all the donkeys. So Saul summoned 210,000 foot soldiers, verse 7. Then Saul attacked the Amalekites. He started to do what God said to do. Verse 8. He took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive. Now, what's wrong with this story? Who was Saul supposed to get rid of? All the Amalekites. That includes the king of the Amalekites. But see, Saul thinks he's got a better plan. Saul thinks he's got a better idea. Saul is going to present a trophy for his accomplishments in front of all the people. And when you can put the king of your enemy in chains as captive in front of your people, what are they going to do? Yay, Saul. Look what our king did. He took King Agag of the Amalekites alive. But Saul totally destroyed Agag's people with the sword. But Saul and the army spared Agag. God has to repeat this to make sure we get the picture. And he spared the best of the sheep. Something is wrong with this story. God said, how many sheep? All. How many cattle? All. All of the good ones. And so the Lord said to Samuel, and these are hard words to read, I regret that I made Samuel king. Makes you want to obey God, doesn't it? Wouldn't it be horrible to hear God say, I regret that I made you? I regret that I gave you ministry opportunity. I regret that I gave you all my good gifts because you haven't done all that I asked you to do. I regret that I made Saul king because, in verse 11, he has turned away from me and has not carried out my instructions. Samuel's response, the text here says, he was angry and he wept all night. You know, when someone in our lives doesn't obey God, it's easy to be angry at them, isn't it? Children obey your parents, and when they don't, it's easy to be upset with them. Maybe even a little angry. Confession time. Yeah. But when's the last time somebody you know who disobeyed God, you wept over them all night? Your heart was broken because God Almighty had given them a wonderful command, a wonderful opportunity, and they blew it. They didn't do what God said. You know, I'm grateful for people in my life who have wept over me. I'm grateful for the people who were angry at me when I didn't disobey. And then look at verse 12. Early in the morning, Samuel got up and went to meet Saul. I don't know if that would have been me. I think I would have just stayed mad at Saul all day long for disobeying God. I think I would have just remained ticked for a long time. He blew it. Let him figure it out. Let him pay the consequences. No, Samuel, the man of God, the prophet of God, the man who knew God and his word, he goes out of his way. He takes a detour. He goes the extra mile to go to Saul. Aren't you grateful for some people in your life who have gone to you when you blew it? Or are you the person who has gone out of your way to some people who you know who are not obeying God? This is a beautiful picture and a model of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ, that we are willing to go out of our way and to confront and to deal with the issues, the problems, the disobedience, and the sin of life. Early in the next morning, Samuel got up and went to meet Saul. But he was told Saul has gone to Carmel. Carmel is a beautiful mountain hill. It's filled with trees, olive trees, and all kinds of other shrubbery of the Middle East. It's on one of the highest points in all of Israel. When you get to the top of Carmel, you look down into the Jezreel Valley. Someday we'll know that valley is the Valley of the Armageddon. It's a gorgeous sight. It expands for miles and miles and miles. You can see Megiddo in the past. You can look just a little bit over, and you know that Cana and Nazareth are up on the hills. It's an amazing sight. And because it was such an amazing place close to the Mediterranean Sea, it became a place of worship. Not only Baal worship, but prophets of God would go there to worship God. Later, if we read our Bibles on, we'll find that that's where Elijah went, up on Mount Carmel, to offer a sacrifice to God and call down fire from heaven and destroy the priests of Baal. It's an amazing place. It's a holy place. It's a religious place. And so Samuel is told that Saul has just gone up to Carmel to do what? To offer an altar to God for the victory that God won over the Amalekites? No, the text says this in verse 12. Saul has gone to Carmel. There he has set up a monument in his own honor. Saul didn't get it. See, Saul thought, almost was enough. doing almost what God asks us to do is enough. And Saul felt he had the opportunity to interpret that in his own way. Look, God, I only saved one Amalekite, the king. We saved the choices of cattle because he had to think fast, because we're going to offer them as sacrifices to you, God. I don't believe that was true. They took the spoils of war for themselves because Saul was a selfish, self-made king. He didn't obey God. And then, can you hear this? While Samuel said, "The Lord bless you," or Saul said, I'm sorry, verse 13, "The Lord bless you, I have carried out the Lord's instructions." How can you say that? It's like not reading your Bible today and tomorrow saying, "Oh yeah, I read God's word yesterday." It's like saying, "I'll pray for you," and I never pray for you. God's instructions are absolutes, and when we don't carry them out and we say we have, and Saul really believed that almost was enough, Saul became self-deceived. There's three kinds of people that we know. We know people who have been deceived by others. Maybe that's you. There are people who, number two, deceive others. And thirdly, they are the self-deceived. And we're told that these are some of the most dangerous people on planet Earth. The self-deceived who believe their own lie and carry out the worst of atrocities. They carry out the worst behaviors in life because they believe their own lie. But then Samuel says this. What's this bleating of sheep and cattle that I hear? What's that baa? What's that moo? Busted, Saul. How do you like Saul's answer, verse 15? Saul answered, "The soldiers did it, not me. But we totally carried out the rest. We totally destroyed the rest." When we go back to verse 2, what did we say were the three most important words of this story? God says, "I will punish the Amalekites." What does Saul now do? He takes credit for it. "I almost did what was needed. I destroyed the rest." In fact, by the way, how do you like my new monument? Pretty cool, huh? Looks a lot like me, holding the sword. In fact, it's bigger than I am. It's quite a monument. Samuel says, "Enough." Verse 16. Samuel said to Saul, "You almost did what God asked. You're done. You're done." You see, God does not accept almost, friends, but God accepts all he requires. Saul was almost obedient, and he knew almost was not enough. The sad part of Saul's almost is that he did not allow the mission of God to be completed. When God says to us, "I have a mission for you at your work, in your neighborhood, among your family, with your church, with whatever ministry opportunity I give you," and when we do almost, guess what? We don't allow God's promise, his mission, to be fulfilled. Our mission gets in the way. Pretty sad. I wonder if for years and years Saul lived with the echo of what Samuel said. What's this bleating of sheep that I hear? I wonder if a year later and Saul was walking along somewhere and he heard some sheep go, "Baa, baa." I wonder if he remembered, "I almost did what God wanted me to do." And he hears some cows another year later mooing off in the distance, and the echo of his disobedience comes to his mind, and he realizes once again, I blew it. I messed up. I didn't do what God asked me to do. See, the problem was that Saul really didn't know God. You see, we sometimes limit the view of God in our lives. And when we limit the view of God, we simply say that God is unreasonable. See if, am I going the wrong way? Oh, there we go. We sometimes limit the view of God. Some of us say, well, almost is good enough because, you see, God is unreasonable. God asks too much of me. God is way too demanding. Saul questioned and challenged the requirements and standards of God in this text. Saul's almost was good enough. God doesn't understand everything. There's a lot that I know that I don't think God really knows. Besides, God is not all-wise, all-powerful. He doesn't understand what I'm going through. I don't hear from him right now. I know what's best for me and my family right now. What God is asking is unreasonable. It's too much. Therefore, almost is enough. Or as you can see up on the screen, God is unconnected. Sometimes we think that God just doesn't connect to where we live. Saul thought he was the greatest guy in the room, smartest guy in the room. And to Saul, God was distant. He was unplugged. God was just out there somewhere. He hasn't made himself very well known recently. And Saul's ego was greater than Almighty God. And he built that monument to himself, not an altar to God. He said, hey, look at me. Look what I've done. And here's a subtle message. Just do your best. How many times have we heard that? Just do your best. You don't need to do everything God says. Besides, what God is asking is unreasonable and it's unconnected. This is your life. Therefore, almost is good enough. Or God is unbendable. God is unflexible. God is too strict. He's too controlling. He's way too confining. God lives in a box. And so Saul listened to the soldiers who were right there with him. Saul caved into peer pressure to overrule the voice of God's Spirit by doing almost, Saul was saying, because God is unbendable. God's word does not need to be the last word in my life. Therefore, almost allows me to be me. Oh, by the way, did you see my monument? Saul's greatest error was not keeping some sheep. His greatest error was not building that monument. His greatest error was not listening to the soldiers. His grave error was not knowing God. And by not knowing God, he took matters in life into his own hands. How many times have we done that? We don't consult God in his word. We aren't spending time in his book. We don't hear from God because we're not listening to God. We're not reading what God has for us. And we just don't know what he has in mind. And so we make our own choices. We say, almost was enough. And to know God is to trust him completely, is to know the most, not almost, of what he has for us. And so we have a choice. We have a choice of almost for God or most for God. You see, almost is not God's love language. God didn't say, I almost love you. He says, no, I love you the most. my joy is the most joy you can ever know. I give you the most peace, the most shalom you could ever experience. I will give you more hope than you know what to do with. That's the language of God. We sang together, I'll never know how much it cost to see my Savior on the cross. Aren't you glad Jesus didn't say, I almost went to the cross? Aren't you glad he says every day, I almost forgive you all your sin? There's a few I just can't do. Aren't you glad God didn't say, I almost sat down at the right hand of the Father? He is the God of the most, not almost. He's a God of fulfillment and faithfulness. There's a story of a rich young ruler. He feels so much like a contemporary of ours, not someone who lived 2,000 years ago. And he would say, I've got the most. He had everything. But the text tells us there was an emptiness. There was a hole inside of this man. And he goes to Jesus to discover what he's missing. He's saying, I almost have this figured out, but I don't. Jesus, what am I missing? He said, the problem is your heart. What I'd like you to do is sell everything you have and give it to the poor. If Jesus came in and said that right now, I think we would all be in a bit of a dilemma. We could even sit here and say, oh, no. Jesus came in, told me to sell. I'm selling. Would we? The man fell on his face, and he went away sorrowful. He went away sad. He was willing to live with almost. I kept all the commandments. Sell all I have. God is unreasonable. He's unplugged. He's unconnected. He's unbendable. It's too much that what God asks of me. Or how about King Agrippa? Everybody know the story of King Agrippa? He's in Caesarea, first century. Paul the apostle is standing before the king. What an audience. And Paul shares the entire gospel with him. An opportunity to go from darkness to light, to go from death to life, to go from the old man to a new man. The opportunity was right there before King Agrippa. He thought about it, and what is his response? Paul, you almost persuade me to be a Christian. And that's where the story ends for Agrippa. Almost. But not the most. Don't be an almost Christian. Don't be almost committed to Jesus. And maybe some of you who are struggling with the big question of what does it mean to know Jesus. Don't almost be a Christian. Don't almost be committed, believers, but don't end up being almost a believer. And don't be caught saying, I almost read my Bible, I almost prayed, I almost stepped up to the plate and served my family, I almost stopped to help the lady with three small children in the checkout lane in front of me. We did almost what God wanted, but we didn't. I almost listened to the godly people in my life, but listen instead to my best friend. I almost forgave my best friend for hurting me, but I still just remain angry. I got real close to forgiving. In fact, I'm almost nice to them now, but I can't forgive them for what they did. Don't be almost forgiving. I almost turned to Jesus as my Savior and Lord, but I thought about what it would cost, and I was almost there, but not quite. Asaph was a man in the Old Testament, Psalm 73. He looked around his culture You see all these wealthy people, and he saw the prosperity, and he saw how wonderful everybody was doing except for him. Verse 2 says, as for me, my feet, Hebrew word, almost slipped. I almost followed the way of the people around me. I had nearly lost my foothold because I envied the arrogant and wicked when I saw their prosperity. But I have kept my heart 100% pure. Asaph almost caved in. He almost gave up his integrity. He almost slipped and fell. But I want to be an Asaph follower of Jesus. How about you? Who gave 100%. Who wasn't going to settle for almost in his life. I don't want to hear the voice of God question my obedience. I don't want to hear, what's that bleeding of sheep that I hear? I don't want to be guilty of holding back what God said, give. I don't want to be guilty of taking for myself what belongs to Almighty God. So fellow Asaph followers, let's love the most. Let's give the most we can. Let's care the most. Let's go out of our way. Let's take a detour like Samuel did to go to Saul who had blown it instead of walking the other way. Let's forgive the most. Let's let go of what other peoples have done in our lives. Let's celebrate the most. Let's find joy, the most joy we can, and give thanks for everything in Christ Jesus, almost for God or most for God. It's your choice. And Father, help us to make those choices and to make them wisely, to make them carefully, to make those choices in obedience to God for exactly what He has for us. Lord, help us to be the most in the name of Jesus.